These are some things that I really, really sincerely wish somebody had shared with me when I was your age and starting out my career. And the first one is, if you want to get reward for talent, if you want to be recognized and rewarded for your talent, then you've got to put people first. If you think that you can get by or get successful only focusing on the skills that you have and think that you'll only get measured by how good you are at what you do, I'm sorry to tell you that that's not the truth. You need to be giving people a great experience, building networks, building relationships, and just generally be great to work with. I work with a lot of producers, have done for a long time. Some are great at what they do. I will, and probably not great on the people side of things. And what I've found is that people will always choose a great, a very good producer who is great to work with over a great producer who is an absolute nightmare or who doesn't offer a great experience. And it's not being about being, you know, nasty or arrogant or aggressive or anything like that. It's just that you've got to put people first and focus on the experience you give them when you're working with them, and you need to build networks. So important. You also need to make a commitment to lifelong learning, because your journey here at JMC is just the very beginning of your journey. You don't stop at the end of your course and go, great, I've done that and I'm set up for life. Because what I will do is guarantee you that one day you're going to sit in front of someone like me and you'll be in an interview and you're going to tell me you've got 5, 10 or 20 years experience. And the first thing I'm going to say to you is, well, do you have 20 years experience or do you have 1 year experience 20 times? Did you think you learned everything you needed to learn at JMC and you've just repeated it year after year after year after year? Because if you've done that, then you've fallen behind. The world moves at an incredible pace and you need to at least move at that pace to keep up. Ideally, you're thinking forward and you're an agent of change. So you really need to have a growth mindset. Okay, so focus on people, not things. Create good experiences and have a growth mindset. Always be looking to improve all the time. And I'm not recommending anything to you that I haven't done or wouldn't do myself. In the last few years alone, I've made a point to study at the world's best business schools. I've just finished one at London Business School earlier this week. And the other benefit of doing this is that you've already got the benefit of studying at JMC. So when you go and see somebody and say, here's where I did my study, that's a great association. So you have this idea of brand transference. You've got the credibility of JMC, which transfers onto you, or also known as branding by association. So enough about me, let's look at the agenda for today. Firstly, we're gonna say the future is sound. I wanna give you some evidence that the future is really, really rosy and you've chosen a great career path and a great subject to study. Then I wanna hopefully show you some different areas where your career could go that you might not have thought about. Then we'll look at audio in real life and what are some real life audio interactions and audio touch points. Then we'll speak about dynamic audio for a very specific reason, show you what is actually possible, starting from a position as you guys are. Audio branding is probably one of my favorite things in the world and really cool. Voice technology, because the world's moving in that direction. And then I'm sure a lot of you are interested in podcasting. So the future is sound. What we do know is audio is growing everywhere. So the mobile phone penetration in Australia is 90%. So that's smartphones. So everybody's got the ability to listen to music, and 72% of us do listen to music on our mobile phones. That will only continue to grow until saturation point of probably 80%. Then you've got people listening to audio online. Now they could be doing that at home or they could be doing it at work. Now, what's interesting about COVID-19 is it's changing how we consume audio, but think about the offices for a minute. Once upon a time, the workplace had lots and lots of offices in it, but now everything is open plan. So we call headphones now the new office door, because once upon a time, when I didn't want to be disturbed or I wanted to concentrate, I'd shut the office door, but now in open plan offices, you put your headphones on. And we're seeing more and more people around the office with headphones on, so you know that people are listening to more audio, and that will continue as well. Then you've got the car. So a million plus cars sold with Apple CarPlay and Android Audio available last year. That's always evolving, always changing. And if we look to the future, what will the car dashboard look like in the future? You've got driverless cars coming up. You guys might be the last generation to get your driver's license. That's quite possible. And audio will continue to play a role in that commute. Down the bottom there, when you ask people what they'd do if they were in a fully self-driving car, you say 35% at the bottom there say they'll do nothing but operate the car. They'll want companionship. People listen to audio, podcast, radio, in part because they like the companionship. If they're making calls, they might want the companionship in the background, eating, text, email, reading, all of that they'd want the companionship with. Watching TV at 21%, I find a bit low. I think once people are in the vehicle and they start to trust how it drives, then they might be sort of comfortable watching or taking their eyes off the road. The big interesting ones down here are the third and fourth ones from the bottom. Drink alcohol. Now that you're not at the wheels, I don't know if that's going to be legal or not. And then the one further up, 7% of people say romance. The curiosity there is, are you in the car by yourself when you're having that romance, or are you carpooling, or what the story is? And maybe it's a result of drinking the alcohol, I don't know. Then we get to voice, or, you know, the new radio, as I like to call it, but it's just a lot smarter and a lot more technology. They're going to continue to grow. I'm going to talk about voice and smart speakers a bit later on, so we'll leave that where it is. Another reason for you guys to be really confident about what you're studying and the future of audio is these predictions that we're moving from a visuocentric culture to one more focused on sound and hearing. Now, there's a lot of reasons for that, and one of those reasons is technology, of course, but you've got to go back to the very nature of sound in the first place, which is it's the only media you can consume without your eyes. You can't do social media. You can't catch up on Netflix. You can't watch TV, movies, read a magazine or a paper. All of that is using your eyes, which means you can't multitask, right? So audio is the only media you can consume safely while doing other things, which gives it a huge advantage in this very busy multitasking world. Some of you might be too young for this movie, but you might recognize this as Wayne's World. It's written on his hat there. And the famous scene in Wayne's World, of course. Now, that isn't what I'd call consuming audio safely, by the way, but it's worth catching that movie if you haven't, if you're not aware of it. Another reason to feel confident about the future of audio is this this guy's prediction and how his what he's promoting. His name is Gary Vaynerchuk, and he's got an agency in New York, London, and Singapore. He's worth hundreds of millions of dollars. He made his money online from online wine sales, actually, but then he started up his own advertising agency. And this is where his head's at and where he sees the future now.
You need to get very serious about sound. We care about only a couple things as people. Money, health, religion. There's not a lot of things we really, really give a fuck about, but one of the things that we care about and always have, but now we're at an all-time high, is time. Anything that aligns you with the end consumer's time is an imperatively big advantage for you. We don't like friction. We don't like friction on our landing pages, and we don't like friction in our lives. Uber became a huge company by selling time, not transportation. Time is imperative, and everybody, even when they don't have a lot of money, spend a lot of money on convenience. You know, the way we roll now is we can listen and do something else. It's hard to watch one of my videos and do something else. It's super easy to listen to what I'm talking about and do something else. Audio saves you time. Every single person in this room, when brushing their teeth in 40 years, will be listening to some sort of voice telling them what they're doing that day, what the weather is, where they're going, what's happening. It's just gonna be that. And if you're smart, you can penetrate somebody's first 7 minutes every single day of their lives and talk about whatever the hell you want them to know about.
So audio is the great time-saving medium because it's the great multitasking medium because it's the only media you can consume without using your eyes. Now, what I've learned here, number one, the platforms will change, but the content will endure. So think about the car for a moment. 50 years ago, that's probably longer now, more like 60, 70 years ago, they had in a car eight tracks, which was a cartridge that you played music from. And then that went to the cassette deck. And I don't know if you guys have ever seen one of those. And that was the next big thing. Then it went to the CD player. So you found those in the cars and that was the latest and greatest. And then you could hook up your MP3 player. And now you can hook up via Bluetooth. But what's constant is that people are listening to the same things. So the platform and how you consume the content may change, but the content will always endure. So how do you create great content? Then you target narrow to catch wide. What I mean by that is that everything starts at the fringes. Fashion, that starts at the fringes of society. Art starts at the fringes of society. Music starts at the fringes of society, and then it catches fire and it catches on and then goes mainstream. And this is true for marketing and most things in life. Think about what people are saying is the ideal employee of the future. Apparently they are T-shaped. And if you think of the letter T across, you've got the horizontal line, and that represents all the different things you know about. And then the vertical line is how much you know about it. So it's this mile wide, or sort of inch wide, mile deep, if you like. So it's saying you need to be an expert in one particular area, but know a bit about other areas as well. I think that we should be aiming to be like an M shape or a cricket wicket shape, where you know a bit about a lot of things, and in say three different areas, you know quite a lot. And the third thing here is that change is constant, but change brings opportunity. Don't fear change, run towards change, be an agent of change, and that will make you a leader. Now, there's a very big difference between a leader and a manager. A manager generally manages from behind. It's not particularly necessarily inspirational, but you don't need authority to be a leader. You don't have to have a manager's title to be a leader. You just need to sort of do things like move towards the, have no fear and move towards the change, because it will always bring opportunity. It should hold no fear for you. So next thing, audio in real life. This is the customer audio journey and looking at all the different touch points that we have with audio in our normal day. And I did my own customer audio journey for a conference I did up in Brisbane a little while ago, where I stayed at a place called the Carlisle Hotel. And my journey there started with the online checkout. So I've gone online to book a room. And once I've booked the room, it's taken me to the page to say, this is confirming your booking. But that was a missed opportunity for an audio touch point, because while it told me that my booking was there, where was the audio reassurance to say, here's a reassuring sound to say that worked, your details are secure online, and what has happened has actually happened. So I thought there was an opportunity for that particular brand. Then you get to the hotel itself, and in the lobby, they're playing a particular kind of music. Now, the music in the lobby of a hotel does two things. Number one, it says something about the hotel itself. And the other thing is it says something about the kind of people who stay at the hotel. If it was playing 20s or 30s music from a century ago, this ain't kind of the place for me, obviously. It's for a much older, older audience. So it tells something about yourself. And if that were the case, I'd probably feel uncomfortable there and wouldn't want to stay there again. Then you get to the front desk, and what we're normally used to is a little bell there to ring the bell for service. But what that should really be is a button to press that triggers some kind of sound that is part of the audio brand and the audio ecosystem for the Carlisle Hotel, not a generic ding sound. Then I get my security swipes, I go to the elevator, press the button, and then that makes another ding to let me know that the doors are open. Now, if you've ever done that and there has been no sound and you've missed the elevator, you'll know what I mean about how important that elevator ding is. But then you get inside the elevator, you swipe to get to the floor you want, and then it gives you a generic beep. I get to the hotel door, I swipe to get in there, it gives me a generic beep. Again, it should be some kind of short audio logo or signature that is related to the audio brand and the audio ecosystem. The first thing I do when I get into a hotel room is jump onto the Wi-Fi, same as the online checkout, give me a reassuring sound to let me know that my details are secure online and I can't be hacked and my privacy is good. And then when I'm on there, give me some audio guides. Tell me what's going on in the city while I'm in the city. Tell me a bit of the history of the hotel. Give me some walking tours around where the hotel is. Add some value through the sense of sound. That's what I'm saying there. Then you turn the TV on, and there's always that music playing on when you turn the TV on in a hotel. And that should be part of your larger audio identity. And then you might go to a restaurant, bar, the gym, or the business center? And how should they all sound different from each other? And how should they sound differently in the morning to during the day to during the night? For example, what should the volume be in the lobby during the day versus in the evening? How should the bar and the restaurant, the fitness and spa lounge, all of that, how should they sound different? And what kind of music and ambience are you trying to create? And there's all different ways of doing that. And that may change from the morning to the afternoon to the evening to meet people's different mood states. And that's what you always need to be conscious of to create the right mood and ambience and the right associations with music. Then let's say after that, I've got to go pay for something. Now we know Visa, they have already got their little sonic trigger. Right? And then MasterCard came out with theirs last year. Now, I won't ask you who created the MasterCard sonic trigger or who did a lot of work on it anyway. I'll just play this video and see how early you can guess who it was.
I've been lucky to have a lot of different experiences with, you know, ways of making music, people I've made music with, from Jay-Z to Paul McCartney to Metallica. I'm Mike Shinoda. I'm a musician and an artist and a producer. When I heard about the MasterCard anthem, I thought there's actually a lot of room to explore in this project. My challenge was finding creative ways to approach that feel simultaneously modern and human. One of the things that I liked about the notes is that when I started to play them using different instruments, they all of a sudden they jumped to other cultures. And that to me was so important. The tiniest little things can actually make a big difference at the end of the day.
I don't know how many of you would have guessed that that was Mike Shinoda at Linkin Park, but it's not the first name that comes to mind when you're thinking, who is MasterCard going to go to work on their audio brand? I'll get into audio branding a bit more in a moment, but it is a nice little window into how people think about music and sound and all the different associations they want to create. So after you've paid for something, then you get to take the product home, if it's not a service, of course. And then what does that sound like? What is the opportunity there for an audio touch point?
That's fucking cool.
I can't disagree. That is pretty cool. That opportunity to surprise and delight. And I would think as the ability to recreate little audio chips comes down, then you'll see more brands doing this, even like, you know, not suitable for children under 4 years old and different warnings and different audio branding signals. That just adds to the experience of having something new. And then because one of those reasons, of course, is that audio influences our experience. And audio is really powerful at the point of purchase as well. I think this is a really funny example of how a big brand uses sound, and it's probably not how you think. You can see here of what Abercrombie & Fitch's image is. It's young, cool people that they have some of these shirtless guys at the front of their stores. The stores are very dark. I don't know if you've ever been in one, but they keep the lighting really low and they keep the sound, the music, really high. It's very loud in there for a very good reason. It keeps these people out, right? What does a brand not want? It doesn't want the dads and the granddads, old people wearing their brands like these guys are, because as soon as these guys start wearing it, all the customers that they're really chasing will stop wearing it. And this exact thing happened to Mambo. It used to be quite a cool brand and a sort of left of center brand. As soon as they put it into Target and Kmart, then mums started buying it for the dads. And then all the cool guys went, nah, if my dad's wearing it, it's not cool anymore. So that's a really interesting way of using sound to keep people away that you don't want buying from you or associating with your brand. There was some cool research out of Las Vegas where they thought, what would happen if we took the sound away from the pokies? So they tried it and instantaneously the takings dropped 24%. So they put the sound back in, of course, and up the revenue went again. And of course, the sound of the cash, the sound of winning That is so important to the experience of using pokies. Why they thought they could take the sound away and have no effect, I do not know. Similarly, a famous study where in a liquor store in Europe, they played some gentle French music in the background. And when they did, 8 out of 10 bottles of wine sold were French brands. But when they changed that to have German music playing in the background, then 7 out of 10 bottles sold were German. Now, when these people who bought the wine, when they were surveyed and said, look, did you actually know what was going on there? They said, I didn't even notice the music was playing. That is the power of music to influence, even at a subconscious level. Another example of that is in a different study, a different liquor store, where they played classical music. When they played classical music, people bought more expensive wine. When they played pop music, they bought cheaper wine. And again, you ask people, so why did it have any influence on your decision? They say, I wasn't even aware that the music was playing. So again, evidence of that at a subliminal level. Because we think music makes everything better. 83% of Americans think that hearing music when shopping in store is great. And that ramps up to 91% when you're talking about 18 to 24 years old, year olds. The shopping experience is more enjoyable, the mood is lifted, and they feel like it's a brand that they can relate and connect to when it's music they like. So what I've learned here is that number one, audio is a tool to achieve things. As I've just shown you, it's a tool to help sell more French wine, or it's a tool to help keep away people that you don't want shopping in your store, or it's a tool you use to keep people in your store longer and shopping longer. It's a tool to let you know that your payment has gone through, or that the elevator is here, or that someone wants to talk to you, i.e. your mobile phone ringing. So always be aware, how can you use audio to solve a problem? What can you achieve by using audio? Because a lot of the time, it's going to add to the user experience. Secondly, you've always got to ask, what do we want people to think, feel, and do when we're thinking about what we're composing or what we're making or what we're doing with audio? Because we do have a physical emotional reaction to sound. So when you're choosing, no matter if it's a sound effect or you're composing something or you're mixing something to a certain level, the first thing you need to ask about the sound or the brief is, what do we want people to think when they hear this? What do we want people to feel when they hear this? And then what do we want them to do? And then what are the decisions I need to make with my sound choices in order to make them do those things and think those things and feel those things? And lastly here, music controls our emotions and emotions control our decisions. We make most of our decisions emotionally and then we tell ourselves rational stories to justify the emotional decision that we've already made. I'm terrible at it when it comes to cars, for example. I need a new car. No, I don't need a new car. I just want a new car. And then I'll tell myself different stories about why it's a good idea. Oh, it'll be a good tax break, or my parents are getting older and so I need a car that sits a bit higher to make it easier for them to get in and out of. If you can control the experience, use music to control the experience, that'll control the emotions and you can influence people's decision-making. And that's a really powerful use of audio. And that's really where I focus on as well. Next, sounds different. I'm going to take you through a few different things that I've noticed recently and not so recently about other ways to think of sound and where you can use sound, starting with physical health. And this is really an outcome of COVID-19, where you've got Dr. Sunshine, what a great name. Hopefully his first name is Ray, from the University of Washington School of Medicine. He thinks that voice-enabled devices, so that could be a mobile phone or a smart speaker or anything that's voice-enabled, should be listening for the sound of dry coughs so that they can detect people who might have COVID-19 symptoms. So imagine that, studying that, of trying to design what a dry cough sounds like and what the parameters of that are so it can recognize it and try to preempt the spread of the disease and more symptoms, even within a household. I find that really amazing. Interestingly, they say that your average smartphone and your average smart speaker has 20 and 10 times the processing power of the average monitoring equipment in an ICU, intensive care unit. So it's quite amazing. You wouldn't want to end up in an ICU if that's all the monitoring equipment they've got in there. You'd be better off with your smart speaker, right? So that's one interesting way that you think, okay, audio and physical health, audio and mental health. There's a company out of Israel who uses voice biometrics, normally for security, because your voice is your voice imprint is every bit as unique as your iris in your eye or your fingerprint. So that's what they normally use it for. But now with so many people working from home and working remotely, they say, we can listen to your voice and analyze the changes in it to determine whether you're stressed, frustrated, fatigued, motivated, or whatever the case may be. So that's a completely new thing that's come out of COVID-19. An extension of that is, like, if you're feeling any of these, you know, stress, frustration, fatigue, etc., have a listen to this track called Weightless by Marconi Union. They're not all 10 hours long. You can find it on Spotify or YouTube. And, you know, find a 5-minute, 6-minute version, there's 10-minute versions, whatever. And it was co-written by Marconi Union and the British Academy of Sound Therapy. And it's been proven by neuroscientists to reduce the symptoms of anxiety by up to 65%. Excuse me. And those symptoms are your heart rate, your blood pressure, and your brain activity. So I encourage you to all have a look at that. Have a listen, put your best headphones on, kick back, relax, and see if it does have a physical or an emotional impact on you. I'd love to hear about it. And actually, if you listen to that DAD, Sleep in My Day Away song, my email is adamwilliams@arn.com.au. Karen can forward that on, or Cass can forward that on to you if you want to have a chat about anything after the presentation. So that's really interesting about how brands are using sound to promote wellness. Here's another one I don't know. I only discovered this like weeks ago, called My Noise. So it's mynoise.net. Now I'm going to try to be risky here and take you there. So if I go stop sharing, and then I go back to share screen, and I'll share a different screen, which is here. Oops. Hang on, I better just come out of that actually, because I don't know if I clicked the right button. Yep, still ticked, share computer sound, brilliant. I don't need to click that every time. So, here we go. So this is saying, if you want to, I'll scroll up again so you can see it, mynoise.net. And this says, if you need to focus in a noisy environment, if you want to sleep, if you want to calm down, if you want to listen to relaxing music, or your room is too quiet, or if you want white noise, if you're a student with ADHD, I work in an office space, an open office space, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm just going to play this one, which I quite like, which is I Want to Sleep. And hopefully everyone's got good headphones on and you can hear this. So just generally rain, but this is what you can do with it. So I'll move, let's say this one up. Kind of cool to play with and customize for what you find most relaxing. Now I won't keep going, but... So someone's had a great idea there. You can just reset the settings there. A great idea there, and I really find that that's quite useful and a good example of new ways of thinking about sound, and sound in particularly with wellness and mental health. So stop sharing, I'll come back to the presentation. That one. Okay. Oh, hang on, I've got to turn that off now, don't I? Okay, hang on a second. Be quiet. There we go. Gone. Excellent. All right. Now, next, education and productivity. You guys might know more about this than I do, but I was reading about this recently and I couldn't find this great article that I'm referring to here. But what it was talking about is that in a classroom environment, if the reverb is too high, then any kids beyond the second row will struggle to hear 50% of what is said. Now, if that is the case, then they have to listen a lot more intently and it's going to be a lot more fatiguing and there's a lot more cognitive load on them, which means that's really going to impact their learning experience and perhaps impact their whole life because they're not sitting in the first two rows or because there is too much reverb in that room. Likewise, in an open plan office, I think the numbers I saw were about a 40% drop in productivity because of a too lively room or office space. Now, on that subject of productivity, if you put in a text-to-speech converter, which is becoming more and more popular, you'll see here, I was really staggered, 47 million results. Now, obviously, they're not all relevant to that, but still, that is a ton of results for something that is fairly new and something that we'll get to see more and more often. So again, like, there's businesses that are going into offices and they talk about you need to design for sound, design for hearing. Don't just design for aesthetics. You know, design for your ears, I think, is a great way to think about it, because everybody just designs for their eyes, what it looks like, or, you know, how you can move around in that space or how you can use it. But what about designing for your ears? It is so important, as those stats I just shared with you said. Another one is you can use sound for security, which is becoming more and more of a threat. This was in September last year, where some poor CEO was absolutely convinced he was talking to or listening to a message from his boss, the group CEO, who was telling him to transfer $243,000 to another bank account. He said his boss had a distinct German accent, and he had no reason to doubt it was him. He said he had the same voice patterns, the same cadence, the same pitch. All of that stuff was indiscernible from the original to him. And it wasn't him. It was a synthetic voice, and he got scammed out of all that money. And then this, so these deep fakes are becoming a real threat and starting up a whole new industry of security and software companies who are trying to make it easier for us to determine, am I speaking to a real person? Or am I speaking to a scam artist? Here's just an example of how far it's come. It's actually more visual than audio, but it shows you that it's starting to get really hard to tell the difference. Imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try. I think if that keeps getting better, we're going to desperately need some way of determining whether it is real or it is not real. Now, if I could see you and I was in the room with you, I'd say hands up if you've got a tattoo, and then I'd ask you, what does your tattoo sound like? Yes, what does it sound like? For this reason.
I probably feel a mix of emotions, happy and sad and excited. I just miss her so much. Her voice is so comforting. So it'll be really nice to hear it again. It's been a while.
What's going through your mind right now?
I'm just really excited about it. I'm just really happy that I got it done.
Pressure's on. Ready?
Yes, I'm ready.
Really cool way to have a permanent memory of those nearest and dearest to you. Or, you know, you can't put any licensed music on that, but you can, you know, if you've composed something yourself and you love it, you can actually put that on there and incorporate it into a design. It doesn't just have to be the sound wave. But I think there's more applications of this than actually just a real skin tattoo. You can have temporary tattoos for promotions, or you could even look at it as an alternative for a QR code. So really, really cool way of looking at sound there, and something a bit different. Now this one, I encourage you to write this down too and download the app, irislistenwell.com, okay? irislistenwell.com. Now, this could be the new battleground for sound and audio, which is audio quality. Number one, they say that over time, since we've been, you know, going to MP3s and compressing audio, that the audio quality has gone backwards. So they're trying to reverse that. And what they promise you is they say that they will put you in the studio with the musicians at the time they recorded the actual song that you're listening to. That's the experience of using their app. The other thing they say is that their technology sort of separates the music, and it's reliant on your brain to put all the pieces together again. That's how it works. So they say it's actually very good for you cognitively to listen this way, because it's great brain exercise, if you like. It has been supported by one of the financial backers is Roger Taylor, the drummer from Queen, and there's a couple of other celebrities behind it as well. The Android app has just been released about 2 or 3 weeks ago. The Apple app's been around a bit longer, and they're also making headphones too. I don't know if they're out yet, but it's a really interesting idea. Again, have a listen. I'd love to hear what you think of it. If you think it makes a big difference and you'd prefer to listen to music that way all the time sometimes, or you absolutely hate it. Really interesting product. And then here we've got this thing. This is just for fun. Sound purely for fun. Around the world, there are, I think, still only 6 musical highways, and this is my favorite of them all. So all those white bits of paint there, they're grooves on the road that vibrate at different intervals to give you that pitch when you're driving at a particular speed. It tells you what speed to drive at. And I'm just thinking, I can see myself driving down the Hume Highway. There's a big billboard there that says McDonald's in 2 kilometres, and all of a sudden I drive over, dun-dun-dun-dun-dun. It's just another way to use sound. So what I've learned here is that, number one, it's this inch deep, mile wide, or are you a mile deep, inch wide? What I was talking before about T-shaped and M-shaped employees. It's, do you want to be a really broad generalist and know a bit about everything, or what areas of sound are you going to focus on, and what do you want to make a career out of? And look, I'm not saying one is better than the other. I'm just saying it might be something that you want to look at. Me, I'm a bit of a generalist myself. I know probably a decent amount about a lot of things. Would I say I'm the world's, you know, foremost authority on any one thing? No, but I think I know enough about enough things to make me a little bit of an audio expert, let's say. So technology and audio are continually converging to create new careers and opportunities. And in some spheres, it's getting to the point where you go, is this technology now or is it audio? And they are so entwined, it's hard to tell whether, you know, you are, you know, a computer or technology whiz, or whether you're an audio whiz. But irrespective, there are more and more opportunities being created every day. And who knows, you might be able to think of a few yourself, and I hope you can. Next, dynamic audio. And I'm sharing this with you because this guy, this product was invented by a guy called Steve Dunlop, who was working as an audio producer at a radio station in London. And he saw a need or an opportunity, and he went out and solved it. And this is what it is. So radio once meant that everyone heard the same message at the same time. And we're talking about advertising now, okay? So we all hear the same ad at the same time, but now we can send different messages to different people who are listening online, and we can automatically tailor their broadcast radio ads in real time as well. Here's how that looks. Normally, a little bit of an education on how a radio station works, but you may already know this. When an ad is played, when you hear an ad played on any or most devices, especially on radio, the ad is predetermined. We know what that ad's going to be, and the ad request comes out and says, we need an ad, and we go, oh, we know what ad it is, it's already in the system, we'll grab that and play it. But with dynamic audio, when in the milliseconds before that ad goes to air, the ad request still doesn't know what ad is going to be chosen because it's not predetermined. What it has to do is go, I need to look at what the day is, the time, the location, the weather, the advertiser data, even the device that the person is listening on, and what is the information we know about that person. And then I need to go find the ad that has all that information in it. And that's the one that I'm going to send to the ad server. And that's the one that's going to be broadcast and heard by the audience. And all of that happens in a split second. So I'm going to take you to a website now to demonstrate it for you, because it's really cool to see what this guy has done. So share screen again. Exactly what I want. Okay, so here's a script in this software by a company called A Million Ads. Now, we are the, uh, I, we, being an Australian radio network, I set up an exclusive arrangement with A Million Ads to represent them in Australia, and we're their exclusive production partner. So what happens here is you can write an ad in their software, right? And in this first part, this is all about the location, contextualization. So every Victorian business owner wants to know someone has their back, and you do that for every location. Then you've got the weather contextualization, someone to help them make hay while the sun shines like today, and someone to lean on when the skies are gray, and you do other variations for other weather. The little yellow stars there and the bold lines, they are all the defaults, just in case technology goes haywire, we will always have a default ad to play. And effectively that default is the normal ad you would hear if you didn't have this technology. The black lines, they are static, they never change. Being that someone has made NAB Australia's biggest business bank, so if you're ready to move your business forward, and then you go to time of day contextualization and can find a few minutes this morning, this afternoon, or this evening, then this is the device you're listening on. Grab your iPhone, your Android, your tablet, your smartphone, or sorry, smart speaker, and search for NAB Business Progress. What you do then is you go to your rules section, and I can click on this, and I can say this line, every Victorian business owner wants to know someone has their back. I'll click on that line and say, I only want that to play when someone is listening in this area. And we can do the same for every other location as well. Then I can click on this line with the weather and say, only play this line when it's raining. Only play this line when it's cloudy, and only play this line when it's sunny. Same with the device, day part. And then the device, I can say, only play this grab your iPhone line when I know someone is listening on a mobile and I know they have an iPhone. So then from there, I'm just going to hit back and I'll copy this little link here. I'm gonna paste it. I'll just put it here. There we go, paste it in here for you. And then show you what we actually do. Once all of that is recorded, then we've got this little player here, which we call, what's going on here? That's the wrong one, sorry. I'll come back to where I was. Oh, go away. You go, oh, silly me. I meant to choose this one. There we go. And I'll put that in there. Cool. So what I just read to you, this is what it sounds like. And on the left, you'll see the script, and the script updates automatically. The audio, you can see, is already loaded. And these are your different variables, and we can test absolutely everything that we've written and recorded. So let's say, we'll say we are in, we won't make it automatic, we'll change it, and we say we're in Tasmania. And we'll also say the weather is a bit rainy down there. We'll make it this morning, so I'll make it say 7 a.m. I'll say the device type. I know you're listening on a mobile phone and it happens to be an iPhone. And you can see it's already loaded, the script has already changed, and this is what it sounds like when it's done.
Every Tasmanian business owner wants to know someone has their back. Someone they can rely on in the face of a downpour, like today, and someone who can help them make hay when the sun shines. Being that someone has made NAB Australia's biggest business bank. So, if you're ready to move your business forward and can find a few minutes this morning, grab your iPhone and search for NAB Business Progress. NAB, more than money.
As you can hear, that does not sound stitched together at all. It actually works together really seamlessly, really cool product. Then, I'll come out of this actually. There's also analytics that come with this and all that kind of stuff as well. So let me share my screen again, and we'll go back to this one. Cool. All right. You're gonna let me, might be taking a minute to load. 2 seconds. So I wanted to share that with you to say that that's a product that has now gone global, that was just created out of a guy's head that went, I'm playing all these ads, but on radio, they're all fixed and I can't change them to be contextualized. Whereas all the world is moving to online advertising, and that is all personalized and it's tailored to what, you know, through the use of cookies, it's now tailored to what we know about that person, what websites you've been to, et cetera, et cetera. So how do we use radio to solve that same problem? And so he's built this as of, I think, August last year, or maybe it was October last year, he'd served his 2 billionth with a B radio commercial using this technology. So likewise, he saw a problem and he fixed it. Then I saw a problem and I fixed it. So my problem that I saw was I took this to market. I spoke to the media agencies, the advertising agencies, and I said, we've got this great thing and you can do this on a platform we've got called iHeartRadio. They said to me, the first two meetings, they said, yeah, that's really cool, except you don't have enough listeners on iHeartRadio. And I thought to myself, well, actually, we do have enough listeners, but just not on iHeartRadio. We've got more than enough. We've got over 5 million listeners a week on FM radio and AM radio. So how do I solve that problem? And we spent 6 months building the technology that enabled one thing to talk to the other thing. And now we're the first company in the world who can actually do this on broadcast radio. So I might have to stop sharing and come back in, because that's still not letting me change the screen. Let's try one more time. Okay. We're going so well. What else can I do? What's this one? Okay, let's try this. Yeah. Oh, this is letting me use it. Okay, where are we? Right here. Okay, cool. Can let me, yep, fantastic. So here's what I've learned on this. Always pay attention to the friction points. The friction points, the problems, the things that you go, wouldn't it be good if this happened? Or I hate the way that this software program does this, or anything like that. Don't just throw that thought away. Write it down, pay attention to it, and then think, can I do something about this? Because if you don't, I guarantee you, somebody else will. Steve Dunlop from A Million Ads, humble radio producer. He saw an opportunity, he looked for the friction point, and he did something about it. Same with me. I saw the friction point. We don't have enough audience for this product, so we've created a bit of software that's fixed that problem, and now we've just gone to market with it, and the response has been tremendous. The other thing is, if you can think it, you can probably do it. There is going to be plenty of people in the world who say you can't do something, or give you reasons why you can't or shouldn't. I say back yourself, right? You shouldn't be the one saying no to yourself. You should be the one still pushing forward and giving yourself permission and asking the question of other people and plowing on regardless. Have the intestinal fortitude to back what you believe. Now, one of my favorite things, audio branding. So a question for you, if you had an audio brand, what would it be? What would you sound like if we had to pick a sound that represented you? You know, like, and it's funny how it creates perception, right? So if you had a little Tinkerbelly sounding audio brand, we'd probably perceive you in a particular way. If it was a tuba, a very deep tuba, we might, you know, think you're a pretty big fella. Or if it was bagpipes, we might wrongly assume that you were Scottish. So, you know, these all things all create associations, but it'd be interesting to do an exercise maybe after the presentation in the coming weeks. If you did have an audio brand, what would it be? What represents you the best? So I represent this company called CZM Son in Australia. They have worked with just all the big brands. You can see on the top line there, all the luxury brands. Then you've got automotive brands, you've got sporting brands, finance, insurance, consultancy, FMCGs, the whole lot, right? And here's why audio branding is important. This is research from earlier this year that looked at TV advertising and the impact of the brand assets on attention. And right up there at number one, head and shoulders above everything else, is your sonic brand cues or your audio branding. You'll see the music hasn't performed particularly well because I think music is often used as a background element. Plus, people use music very tactically. And you don't create great brand associations when you do things tactically. You need to do it more strategically. So when I talk about audio branding, I'm talking about the audio representation of your brand at every single stakeholder touch point, much like we did with that the customer journey earlier on in the presentation. And it's made up from your sonic logo right at the middle, which is a 2 or 3 second celebration of everything about your brand. Then around that, you've got your sonic DNA, which is your long form storytelling using music. It can be 30 seconds, it can be 30 minutes, it can be whatever you need it to be. And there can be multiple versions of it as well, and I'll demonstrate that in a moment. And then your musical universe is all the different touch points that you have. And all those different touch points might look like this. Don't need to study that, but I use this slide when I'm presenting to clients and advertisers. And then if you do that well, what you end up with is a unique audio trademark, because audio can be trademarked, and some, you double your brand iconography. Because when we think of brands, we generally think in terms of visuals, right? The Nike swoosh. And what is a logo? What does it do? It's a shortcut to meaning. So I see that little swoosh and I go, Nike, running, shoes, exercise, fitness, sports teams, celebrities, even now more than ever, like political movements, even maybe social responsibility, maybe not, fashion. So there's all these different associations that come when I see that. Just like when I see the Apple logo, you might think of the color white of Steve Jobs, Steve Wozniacki. You might think of creativity, of innovation, of music, of headphones, wireless headphones, you know, all those different things, just because you're seeing a little apple with a bite taken out of it. Now, yes, you can do that visually, but you can also do it using sound. Audio logos from all different ways of walks of life. And why that's so effective is that music is universally understood. No matter what language you speak, no matter what country you grew up in, or what your culture is, the human mind assigns meaning to sound very quickly, and we're very good and consistent at it. And it influences actually what we see. So I'm going to play a couple of things for you now. You're going to see the same thing 3 times, but I'm going to change the audio and see how you feel differently about those brands or what you're looking at. Oops, I have to do it this way, do I? Yeah. So for all intents and purposes, very different companies, very different feels to them. I've always wanted to put like a Jaws theme under one of those and to demonstrate really how it can influence our perception and our mood. A great way to do that is to demonstrate this case study from Renault, who wanted to transition from a product brand to a lifestyle brand. In other words, they wanted to stop focusing on the car and they wanted to start focusing on the purchaser or the driver or the owner of the car. And they wanted to get a bit younger as well. So this is what they sounded like. I'll play that again. Very metallic, very mechanical. It's not really warm and fuzzy or anything human about that. But when you add the human voice, this is what happens. Right, straight away with the human voice, it makes it a lot more human. Now, so if that's your master brand, I'll play that one more time. Oops. Then Renault also have their commercial vehicles division. Now, it's still a Renault, but obviously it's a very different communication piece. The target market is different. The associations are different. You want it to be rugged and tough and durable, and it's a lot more masculine. So should it sound like the previous audio logo or not? Well, yes and no. It still needs to be identifiable as Renault immediately, but it needs to say something different. So this is what that sounds like. You may notice there, I'll play them back to back so you can see the difference. Oops. Passenger lifestyle brand. Commercial brand. It's a lot more robust and rugged, you know, but still you can tell it's Renault. And then with Renault Sport, it just needs to sound. Just needs to sound fast. And so obviously they've taken the pitch of the F1 engine and tuned that to the melody. Now, so your audio logo it allows you for a lot of flexibility. You can use sound in lots of different ways. If you remember, Oh What a Feeling Toyota, they recorded that with dogs barking, cats meowing, car doors slamming, every instrument known to man. It is not creatively limiting in any way, shape or form. You could do a Christmas version of this with bells in it, for example. Really diverse, but that's just the very center of that circle I showed you, the audio logo. Then you've got the audio identity. And if this is all about being fast and energy and on the edge, then I think this piece of music does it really well for Renault Sport. I don't know about you, but that makes me want to drive fast. Once I get in, absolutely bang it. Drive it like you stole it, as they say. And I love that line in there too. I'm in love with a monster. I think that's really, really cool. So what I've learned about audio branding and audio's use for brands is, number one, sound creates associations. Whatever it is, the instrument you use, the chords you use, the volume it's at, the number and combination of instruments, it's going to create an association. So you need to do that very deliberately and not leave it to chance. You go, these are the associations I want to create. What sounds, combinations of sounds, melodies, chords, notes is going to create those associations. The human mind can't help but create those associations. Sound influences perception. Sort of mentioned it before, that, you know, if you heard bagpipes, you would perceive somebody to be, you know, the association and the perception is both, that you associate that with Scotland. So sound influences perception, and that can be really, really powerful. For example, if I, you know, if there was a company that was big, bold, successful, confident, progressive, you can almost imagine what that sounds like versus a brand that was natural, organic, boutique, sort of maybe small or delicate, something like that. Immediately you go, there's a lot of space in that second one, and there's not much space in the first one. And you think there's difference in volume as well. So that's the perception. And when you're trying to come up with those set of associations and music, accuracy beats popularity. I've learned this from experience that if you're playing different things to people to get their opinion, they're probably going to gravitate to what they like the most. So they think, oh, well, this one's the most popular. But that's not what you're aiming for. You're aiming for the sounds, the melody, the audio logo that most accurately represents the associations that that business wants to have. Again, come back to, what do you want people to think when they hear it? What do you want people to feel when they hear it? The versions and the music and the notes and the instruments that do that best need to win over the popular choices, because people are going to gravitate to the versions and the sounds and the music that suits their personal taste, which is likely to mean it's going to live closer to the mainstream music world. So it's not going to be very differentiated, not going to be very unique. It won't be able to stand the test of time, and it won't stand out from the crowd. So go for that accuracy over the popularity. Next, voice technology. One of the funniest things I saw last year was people creating voice activated stickers and putting them on things like hand dryers in public toilets. And, you know, it said, you know, say dry hands loudly to activate. And so people would, you know, dry hands. And of course, it's never going to work because it's not voice activated. So if you're bored and have got a printer and you want something to do, there you go make some stickers and amuse yourself. So when we think about voice technology, we're largely thinking about smart speakers, but it isn't really all about the smart speaker, even though it has seen some huge growth. It is the fastest consumer electronics device to hit mainstream adoption in the US. You can see here, it took 14 years for PCs to get to 50%, or from 10% to 50%. It only took smart speakers 3 years. By comparison, tablets and smartphones took 4 years. So they are a really growth product. But when we're talking about voice, we're not really talking about the hardware, the smart speakers themselves. We're talking about what's inside them and what's inside your phones. So it's the digital voice assistants. Now you might think to yourself, oh, digital voice assistants, or maybe digital voice recognition. How long has voice recognition been around? Would that be 10 years that now? Would it be a bit longer? Have a look at this. You might be a bit surprised.
Last year, an experimental machine that recognizes the human voice was introduced to the press by its inventor, William C. Dirsch, of the Advanced Systems Development Division.
So that was 1961, IBM, something called the IBM Shoebox. 1961, so it took another 49 years for Apple to turn that into Siri, for voice recognition to turn into a voice assistant. So for now a decade, we've all had access to voice assistants, voice recognition technology at the palm of our hand. It's in our cars. It's not all about that though. You've got the smart speakers, wearables, voice-enabled TVs, even voice-enabled toilets, for goodness sake. And there's a reason for that, is that the technology or the consumer manufacturers, they all want to get the data from being able to have that voice recognition and people talking to them, because data about people is powerful. It helps them serve better messages, helps them service them better, helps them sell more products. Now, last year it was estimated there were 2.5 billion voice-enabled devices in the world, more than tripling in the next few years to 8 billion, and revenue of almost $8 billion as well by 2023 in the US alone. Now, that gives rise to this idea that voice commerce, people buying things only using their voice, is the fourth sales channel behind buying in-store or online or via a mobile. And it'd be interesting to know how many of you guys have actually bought something only with your voice, if any at all. Now, as evidence of how this is growing and that this is not new technology, Prime Day is Amazon's annual sale for their subscribers, 24-hour sale. Back in 2016 was their second annual Prime Day. They hold it in June. And they put an offer into the marketplace and they said, if you buy any one of these specific products using only your voice through an Alexa device, then you'll get an extra $10 off. And the result of that was that on average, they sold one product by voice every second for that sale for 24 hours. So that's 86,400 people bought something in 24 hours only using their voice. And that was 4 years ago now. That's incredible, really. When you look at something more recent, the 11th of the 11th last year, which is Alibaba's global shopping festival, used to be called Singles Day. On that one day alone, more than 1 million people not only bought something using their voice, but they paid for it using their voice as well. So it shows you a whole new world of commerce is coming through sound and through people using their voice. The next step of that is Google. Their new mantra is, we want to be, that they started off as, we want to be the world's library, effectively. We want to have all the world's information. Now they've gone, we want to be the easiest way to get things done. And this video is an example of that.
El Cocotero, how may I help you?
Hi, I'm the Google Assistant calling to make a reservation for a client. This automated call will be recorded. Can I book a table for Tuesday the 12th?
Okay, cool. And how big is the party?
It's for two people.
Great. And when did you say they want to come in?
Tuesday at 7 p.m.
Okay, let me check.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have 7, but we can do 8.
Yeah, 8 p.m. is fine.
Perfect. And can I get their name?
First name is Anna.
Okay. We'll see Anna Tuesday. Thank you.
Okay, awesome. Thanks a lot.
So this is not fantasy. This is actually happening in the US at the moment. It's something called Google Duplex. They're trialing it in different cities in the US. And you're not listening to a real voice there, of course. That is a synthetic voice generated by Google that is just responding to commands from the person making the request. They might say, hey, book me a table at El Cocotera tonight at 8 p.m. And then it goes away and does it, makes that call for you, et cetera, et cetera. So again, it's a synthetic voice and technology that is really coming along in leaps and bounds at the moment. Now, true story, I also auditioned for the role of the Google Assistant, but my audition didn't go so well. It sounded more like this.
Hi, I'm the Google Assistant, calling to make a reservation for a client.
That is actually me using some cheap software to create my own synthetic voice, and you can kind of tell it's me.
Hi, I'm the Google Assistant, calling to make a reservation for a client.
Clearly, I wasn't using the same software as those criminals had that got the $243,000, but I had to record a certain number of lines to be able to get it to that level, and I lost patience and went, fine, I'll just go with that. The next stage of this is, in terms of advertising, is where you might hear an ad. It's going to ask you a question, and then you respond to that question, and then the ad responds back to you depending on what you say. And that's been available actually for a couple of years. I'm working with, I think it's a Swedish company called Instrumatic AI to bring that to Australia. And that's quite exciting for us too. So what I've learned here is that when people talk about voice, it's not about smart speakers. We saw it's smart homes, it's light switches, it's gonna be doors, it's TV, so you don't have to use a remote control. And I tell you that there's concerns about privacy with talking to these things, but what I believe will happen is that most people, and Australians are pretty lax on privacy. When you look at the research, they're like, yeah, we're not that worried about it. Not as much as other markets anyway. And what you'll find is that people go, the world knows so much about me through social media, at least, and everything else, that what are they going to learn that isn't already common knowledge or that other technology companies don't already have? Facebook, for example, holds over 1 million points of information on every one of their users, as scary as that is. So you kind of go, I'm not really giving anything else away. And people will give up that privacy for the convenience of what the product offers. If we have another pandemic, this will drive voice adoption even further, because how do we transfer a lot of bugs and disease? By touching things. If you can say door open, don't touch it. If you say lights on, don't touch it. If you say microwave 30 seconds, you don't touch it. And most of these things are out in the marketplace now. So another pandemic that will go through the roof. And I think synthetic voices and AI could really, really change the world. I know that the city of Abu Dhabi used AI to create its own audio logo. It's actually a song of the city. And by the way, it's terrible, but it could still do it. Also, there's technology where you can show it, let's say, five paintings by Renoir, and then it will create another Renoir painting for you, an original piece of work. And that's really the big gap that we thought that computers couldn't do, to be creative and create things of its own volition. You could argue, well, it has to see the Renoir first before it knows how to create a Renoir, but still, it is creating original pieces of work. Podcasting, fool's gold or the real deal? We're on the home stretch, guys. So what's indisputable is that people are now listening to the things that they used to read, and podcasting is a great example of that. It originated in the 1980s as audio blogging. As we know it, podcasting was really born in 2004. And at the moment, there's over 1 million different podcasts and over 30 million different episodes. Now, most of the Australian population is familiar with the term podcasting, and roughly a third of us has listened to a podcast ever, 22% of those being in the last month and 15% in the last week. And the average avid podcast listener listens to 6 different shows per week. Now, how do we compare on a global scale? You can see we're equal 4th. South Korea has the best IT, the best internet speeds, etc., in the world. So they are really early adopters of technology. We're not doing too badly. And when we're consuming podcasts, well, most of the stuff we listen to is coming from overseas. We're not fussy about where it comes from. We'll just listen to whatever the best content there is. Now, of the 22% that is Australian generated, half of that comes from the ABC. So that can't be commercialized in any way, which is good in a way for consumers, I suppose, bad in a way for advertisers, because I'm sure they'd love to access those audiences and those shows. Podcasting has grown by almost, it's almost doubled in the last year, top categories being comedy, news, and society and culture. And the number one podcast in Australia is Stuff You Should Know. And it usually is the number one. I think that's pretty consistently the number one podcast in Australia. All this other information here, the different podcast publishers, all that is saying those brands on the left, they're all the different publishers, or that's where you can, they're the brands that can serve and sell advertising in podcasts. And the number on the right just means they represent 23 of the top 100 podcasts that you can get advertising in. And that's not to say that's exclusive. You know, Wooshka at number two might have this, 21 of the 23 of iHeart Podcast Network Australia, which is part of this company as well, a part of the Australian Radio Network. Now, I haven't gone really deep in that. It's not really my strong suit, podcasting, but I have learned a couple of things that are really, really important if you're into podcasting. The number one thing is curation and measurability are podcasting's biggest challenges. For example, how do people know what to listen to, what is good other than word of mouth? And how do advertisers know exactly how many are being listened to? Because downloads and listens aren't the same thing. For example, I download tons and tons and tons of podcasts. I don't listen to that many, but I do download a lot. So the stats will say, oh, this has got this many downloads, so it must be that many people listening. No, there are estimates that it's as low as 5% of downloads actually transfer to listens. I'm sure it's not all like that, but that's a real barrier for the podcasting industry. So is the ability to curate, or for people to understand what they should listen to and what they shouldn't. One of the other things I heard, I think it was the number is 60%. 60% of podcasts won't ever be downloaded. They get made, they get put online, friends and family maybe, and then nothing else. So that's a bit scary too. And that's all about that curation problem. The second thing is the low barrier to entry means discoverability is the biggest challenge for podcasters, i.e. it's like YouTube without the pictures, right? Anybody with a microphone and a computer and an internet connection can create a podcast. It's that easy. And because of that, that low barrier to entry, there's so much stuff on there. It doesn't mean something has to be particularly good. And that's going to be a barrier for podcasters. The discoverability means, okay, I've created one and I'm pretty proud of it, but how do I tell people about it? How do they know it's there? And a lot of companies I talk to have this idea of, you know, make it and they will come. No, well, number one, when brands make podcasts, 9 times out of 10, it's all about them and what they think is important, but there's no audience for it. So I'm encouraging people, if you are thinking about making a podcast, number one, make it for the love of it and because you're passionate about something. Think about what I spoke about before in terms of content. Aim for the fringes, right? Target narrow to catch wide. If you do really well at a particular area, then that will catch on and grow and grow and grow, kind of like true crime did. Don't try to be all things to all people. And then, you know, word of mouth will grow, hopefully, but otherwise you need to find a way for people to discover who you are. So I think that's about it. I'm sorry, that's taken a lot longer with our few technical glitches than we thought. I'm going to end on just a quick little bit of audio / video, just again to sort of maybe have a big ending and show you the power of audio. Class. That's an oldie but a goodie, but geez, the music is really, really powerful in that, and excuse the crude little sound in there as well.